Wars, Knights of the Old Republic, KOTOR, is a media franchise of space western role-playing video games created and developed by BioWare, which have seen releases on...
Whoa, we're not having that again. We have to sort this out, lad. Lad?
I've not seen him, but I have seen some shifty-looking badgers. You know, badgers are part of the weasel family?
Not now, Keith. In time. Right, looks like it's up to me and thee to sort out this week's video. Bloody hell. Right, here we go. Welcome, Ladles and Jelly Spoons, Jedi and Sith, to Kohigh Mathy's YouTube channel.
Coming at you live via videotape from the Orbital Broadcast Bunker.
It's Britain's first and only airborne subterranean studio in a galaxy far, far away. But today, we are delving into the rich and captivating world of Star Wars as we explore one of the most beloved and influential games of all times, Star Wars, Knights of the Old Republic.
In this video, we'll be taking a deep dive into the world of KOTOR, as the kids call it, and exploring its captivating narrative, the tough moral choices that test our allegiance to the light or the dark side of the Force, and the unforgettable companions that we meet along the way.
Now, let's jump into hyperspace and embark upon an unforgettable adventure with Star Wars, Knights of the Old Republic. As I'm sure will come as no surprise, is in the book, 1001 Video Games You Must Play Before You Die, by Tony Mott, General Editor of Edge Magazine. You can try this one if you want, Mr. B. I fully recommend it. Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic,
or KOTOR as the kids like to call it,
stands as an exemplary testament to the power of storytelling and immersive gameplay. It was developed by BioWare and released in 2003, but this iconic role-playing game effortlessly transports players to a galaxy far, far away and offers an unforgettable journey through the rich and captivating Star Wars universe. Prepare to embark upon an adventure of epic proportion as you delve with me into the marvels of KOTOR.
Meow. Meow, 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 meow.
One of the greatest strengths of KOTOR lies in its masterfully crafted narrative, set thousands of years before the events it films. The game introduces players to a time when the Jedi and the Sith Orders are locked in a bitter conflict. Immerse yourself in a gripping tale of intrigue, betrayal and redemption as you navigate through the complexities of a galaxy on brink at war. The story unfolds through well-written dialogue, captivating cutscenes and memorable characters that will leave an indelible mark on your gaming experience.
Good to see you up instead of thrashing about in your sleep. You must have been having one hell of a nightmare. I was wondering if you ever...
In July of the year 2000, BioWare and LucasArts made an exciting announcement regarding their collaboration on a Star Wars role-playing video game for PC and next-generation consoles. Joint BioWare CEO expressed his enthusiasm, stating,
"The opportunity to create a richly detailed chapter in the Star Wars universe is incredibly exciting for us. We are honoured to be working with the extremely talented folk at LucasArts, developing a role-playing game based upon one of the most high-profile licenses in the world."
The game, eventually named Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic, was officially unveiled at E3 2001, after approximately 6 months of development. According to LucasArts, discussions between the companies began as early as 1999, with substantial progress being made at the beginning of the year 2000. The decision to set Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic 4,000 years prior to Star Wars Episode I The Phantom Menace was an early revelation about the game. LucasArts presented BioWare with options for the game's setting, and BioWare CEO explained,
"Now, LucasArts came to us and said that we could do an Episode 2 game, or LucasArts said we could go 4,000 years back, which is a period that's hardly ever been covered before."
Opting for the latter, BioWare chose the distant time period to have more creative freedom. Their goal was to create content that captured the essence of the film while serving as a distant precursor. Conceptual work had been approved at The Ranch, but BioWare found the process surprisingly smooth.
"There were good suggestions made, and they made the game better, so we were happy to do them. Overall, we were really happy with the results. We felt as though we had enough freedom to truly create something wonderful."
The collaboration with LucasArts allowed BioWare to bring their vision to life whilst honouring the Star Wars universe. BioWare and LucasArts aimed for a gameplay duration of approximately 60 hours, reflecting BioWare's previous titles.
Yeah, well, Baldur's Gate were about 100 hours of gameplay, if not more, and Baldur's Gate 2 were at least 200 hours. The Critical Path playthrough of Baldur's Gate 2 was at least 75 hours.
While Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic would be smaller in scope, even if it were 60% smaller, it would still offer around 100 hours of gameplay. The development team were focused on crafting numerous expansive areas, including worlds and spaceships, to provide players with a wealth of exploration and content to experience. Their goal was to ensure a satisfying gameplay duration of 60 hours whilst delivering a vast and engaging adventure. According to the project director, one of the notable accomplishments and risks in development was the combat system. He expressed the team's ambition to combine the strategic elements of BioWare's Baldur's Gate series and Neverwinter Nights with fast-paced cinematic 3D action. This endeavour necessitated the creation of something innovative and unprecedented in the gaming landscape. Designing the combat system presented a formidable challenge, as it required addressing multiple factors that were difficult to conceptualise initially. The developers aimed to cultivate open-ended gameplay, allowing players various approaches to overcome challenges. They likened certain situations in the game to the flexibility seen in Deus Ex, where multiple paths and the utilisation of specific character skills are required to progress through an area. This emphasis on diverse gameplay options added depth and replayability to the overall experience.
Ansel's gonna escape Terrace. She's gonna need our help, and we'll probably need hers.
You know, despite the nature of the huts seen in Star Wars films and various literature, none of the huts that you'll meet in Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic is a kingpin of organised crime, and most have almost nothing to do with the criminal activities at all.
LucasArts and BioWare made the decision to focus on developing Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic for PC and Xbox platforms. Amongst the reasons for choosing the Xbox, BioWare's expertise in PC game development played a significant role. They were more familiar with the Xbox compared to other consoles, enabling them to execute their creative vision more effectively.
We could do things we wanted to do on the Xbox without as much effort as we'd need to do on the PlayStation 2 or the Nintendo GameCube.
The Xbox's recent success and the opportunity to release one of the console's initial RPGs were additional factors that influenced the decision. While BioWare had previously worked on MDK2 for the Dreamcast and PlayStation 2, they noted that their experience with other consoles helped them approach the Xbox development with the right mindset. In comparison to other platforms, developing for the Xbox was relatively straightforward, providing a favourable environment to bring their game to life. During the development process, they acknowledged encountering several challenges. One of these hurdles involved striking the right balance in terms of graphical detail.
Yeah, given the extensive AI and scripting, the abundance of character models, and the vast environments in our games, we put hardware under a different kind of stress compared to most games.
This unique stress made it challenging to accurately anticipate the game's performance. To bring Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic to life, the development team had to utilise the Odyssey engine, a modified version of the Aurora engine previously employed in BioWare's Neverwinter Nights. The engine was meticulously crafted, boasting impressive levels of detail for its time. Players could witness grass swaying in the wind, dust sweeping across Tatooine, and sand billowing as the players traversed the seabed. These intricacies added depth and realism to the game's immersive world. The character animations in Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic were meticulously choreographed using 3SD Max. The distinction between console and PC necessitated modifications in the graphics department.
Well, console games are typically played on a TV across a room, whilst PC games are enjoyed on a monitor just inches away.
As a result, console games prioritise close-up action and overall visual quality, whilst PC games emphasise the potential of high resolution and incredibly detailed textures. Furthermore, the disparity between game controllers and mouse and keyboard setups influenced certain design choices. In the PC version, players have access to additional locations to explore, along with more non-playable characters, items, and weapons. These expansions were later made available to Xbox players through Xbox Live. Additionally, the PC version supported higher display resolutions, reaching up to 1600 by 1200, and features higher resolution textures, enhancing the visual experience on compatible systems.
The gameplay mechanics of KOTOR strike a remarkable balance between accessibility and depth. Combat seamlessly blends turn-based and real-time elements, providing tactical options whilst maintaining an engaging engaging pace. As you progress, you'll acquire new skills, new force powers and abilities, allowing you to customise your characters to suit your preferred playstyle. The light side and dark side morality system add an extra layer of complexity, granting you the freedom to shape your character's destiny and explore the ethical dilemmas of the Star Wars universe.
Visually right, KOTOR has aged gracefully. The environments are beautifully designed, capturing the essence of Star Wars with its distinct blend of futuristic technology and ancient civilizations. The attention to detail is commendable, bringing iconic locations to life and immersing you in a world brimming with authenticity. Combined with a rich atmospheric soundtrack, the game creates a truly cinematic experience that transports you deep into the Star Wars mythos.
Right, we're gonna talk about the plot, so you know, spoilers!
The game begins with the player's character awakening aboard the Republic ship, the Endar Spire, as it comes under attack by Sith forces led by Darth Malak above the city planet of Tauris. Republic soldier Trask Ulgo advises the player to evacuate the ship. As they fight their way to the escape pods, Trask sacrifices himself to ensure the player's escape. The player is later rescued by Kartho Nasai, a skilled pilot and war hero. They crash land on Tauris and, after a vision, awaken in an abandoned apartment. Karth explains that Tauris is under Sith control, and they must find Jedi Knight Bastila Shan, known for her battle meditation abilities. Along their journey, the player recruits companions such as Mission Veo and Zailbar. The group rescues Bastila and escapes Tauris on the Ebon Hawk before the Sith destroy the planet. Seeking refuge on Dantooine, the player trains as a Jedi, discovers a star map, and learns about the Star Forge, which powers Malak's fleet. They travel to various planets, including Manaean, Tatooine, Kashyyyk, and Korriban, in search of more star maps. Along the way, they recruit additional companions like Yuhani, HK-47, and Jolie Bindo. After finding the remaining star maps, the player's party is captured by Darth Malak. It is revealed that the player character is actually an amnesiac Darth Revan, and the Jedi Council erased their memories. Bastila sacrifices herself, and the player escapes. On the light side path, the player confronts and either redeems or kills Bastila, defeats Malak, destroys the Star Forge, and is hailed as a hero. On the dark side path, the player aligns with Bastila, overthrows and kills Malak, seizes control of the Star Forge, and becomes the Dark Lord of the Sith once again. The choices made throughout the game determine the player's path and shape the ultimate fate of the galaxy.
There are two endings depending on the choices that your main character makes, and a third funny ending can be accessed by pressing a button combination just before the final confrontation with Dark Malak.
Right, now the character development in KOTOR is truly exceptional. From the moment that you step into the shoes of your customizable protagonists, you'll find yourself deeply invested in their journey. Along the way, you'll recruit a diverse cast of companions, each with their own distinct personalities, motivations, and fascinating backstories. The relationships that you forge with these companions are rich as well as dynamic, influencing both the narrative and gameplay. You can engage in meaningful conversations and form deep connections and witness the impact of your choices on their loyalty and growth.
Darth Revan, the main protagonist of Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic, is voiced by Reno Romano, a Canadian actor well known for his voiceover work. He voiced the Batman in the animated series The Batman, Spider-Man in Spider-Man Unlimited, and in video games, the PlayStation 1 game Spider-Man and the PlayStation 1 game Spider-Man 2 Enter Electro. He also had an uncredited cameo in X2 Wolverine's Revenge. He voiced Luis Serra in Resident Evil 4 and Eduardo Riva in Extreme Ghostbusters. But he's probably best known as being the original voice of Tuxedo Mask in the 90s English dub of the animated series Sailor Moon. Darth Malak is introduced as the reigning Dark Lord of his time, after following his former Sith Master Revan through the Mandalorian Wars and even to the dark side of the Force. This former Jedi Knight, believing himself to be stronger and more deserving, usurps Revan's title of Dark Lord by ordering his own ships to fire upon the Dark Lord, whilst the latter defends himself against the Jedi strike team led by Bastila Shan. He is voiced by Rafael Ferrer, an American actor who's mainly known for voicing Darth Malak in Knights of the Old Republic and its sequel. Fun fact though, his brother Miguel Ferrer was an American actor known for playing Morton in the film RoboCop, and he was good friends with Carrie Fisher, who helped her prepare for her Princess Leia audition. Bastella Shan, a young Jedi Knight proficient from a young age in battle meditation. She enters the story after she is saved by Revan from the Black Vulkas on Taris. She leads Revan to the Jedi Academy on Dantooine, and encourages the Council to take him on as a Jedi Initiate, which they reluctantly agree to. She is voiced by Jennifer Hale, a Canadian-born American voice actress best known for her works in video game franchises, such as Baldur's Gate, Mass Effect, Metal Gear Solid, BioShock Infinite, Metroid Prime, and Overwatch. In 2013, she was recognised by the Guinness World Records as the most prolific video game voice actress.
Right, now did you know that Bastella Shan's character was originally going to be Vimma Sunrider, a Jedi from Dark Horse's comics Tales of the Jedi series. The name Bastilla were originally meant for Juhani's character. Eventually it was decided to create a different character rather than use Sunrider. The new character were going to be named Bastilla, and the other character were just renamed to Juhani.
Karth Onsi, an intensely loyal commander and expert pilot with the Republic. He is voiced by Raphael Sabarge, an American actor and filmmaker, perhaps best known for his role as Jiminy Cricket slash Dr. Archibald Hopper on Once Upon a Time, although video game fans might recognise him as Scorch from Star Wars Republic Commando, or Kaden Alenko in the Mass Effect trilogy. Candorous Ordu, a jaded Mandalorian war veteran working as a mercenary for the Exchange crime lord Davik Kang on Taris. He's voiced by John Saigon, an American actor and comedian. Saigon was noted for his television work, also his voiceover work as Solidus Snake in Metal Gear Solid 2 Sons of Liberty. Saigon sadly died of cancer in 2017 at the age of 63. HK-47, a hunter-killer assassin droid that is built by Revan towards the end of the Mandalorian Wars. They're voiced by Christoph Tabori, an American actor and television director. Tabori was also an established voice actor. In KOTOR, he voices HK-47, HK-51 and HK-55, as well as providing voices for other characters in other Star Wars related products. Jolie Bindo, an aging Jedi who has spent the last 20 years in self-imposed exile deep in the Shadowlands of Kashyyyk. He's voiced by Kevin Michael Richardson, an American actor known for his distinctly deep voice. He's mostly voiced villainous characters in animations and video games. In films, Richardson voiced Goro in Mortal Kombat from 1995 and reprised the role in Mortal Kombat Legends: Scorpion's Revenge in 2020. He voiced Kamek in the recent Super Mario Bros. Movie and the Shredder in the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles movie from 2012. He received 2 Daytime Emmy Award nominations for voicing the Joker in The Batman. Juhani, a volatile Kathia Jedi Knight who joins Revan and his companions in their quest to find the star maps. She's voiced by Courtney Taylor, an American actress who is best known for her voice roles in video games such as the Mass Effect series. She plays Ada Wong in the Resident Evil series and the female sole survivor in Fallout 4.
You know, when player first meets the female Jedi Juhani, they can choose whether to turn her back to the light side or to kill her. In doing the latter, the player will have a showdown with another female Jedi who claims to be her lover. She also makes another appearance later in Corbin, where she attempts to make one final attempt to avenge her lover. Furthermore, when playing as a female character and talking with her, she will occasionally flirt with the player, as in classic Baldur's Gate 2 fashion. By the end of the game, she confesses to have romantic feelings for you, the player, and you can return them. Thus, these two females are the first two homosexual characters in the Star Wars universe.
I believe it's actually pronounced Jihan, and it's actually a boy's name in Finland and Estonia, don't you know?
Tell you what I do know is that I'm rather enjoying this video, and if you are enjoying it at home, Ladles and Jelly Spoons, please be sure to let us know in the comment section down below. And whilst you're there, why not check out our other social media platforms? And of course, if you're not subscribed to the channel, then you can do that down there as well. Right, now back to this Star Wars malarkey.
Mission Vow, a young wisecracking Twi'lek street urchin from the lower city of Taris. Voiced by Catherine Tabor, an American actress best known for voicing Padme Amidala in Star Wars The Clone Wars. Tabor got her break in video game voice acting in Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic. She also voiced Pinello in Final Fantasy XII, for which she was nominated for a National Academy of Video Game Trader Reviews Award in 2006. And rounding up the rest of the cast, we have Phil LaMarr, the voice behind Samurai Jack, as the voice of Gadon Theek, Ed Anser of Lou Grant fame as the voice of Master Vorok, Charles Dennis as the voice of Davik Kang, and finally J. Karen Thomas as the voice of Kibala Yurt.
Naturally, the game has numerous references to the Star Wars movies. The line, "My name is... I'm here to save you," which was said by Luke Skywalker when saving Princess Leia Organa.
Mission Vow says, "I have a bad feeling about this," at least twice, and this is of course a homage to the repeated line in each of the Star Wars films.
Probable ancestors of characters seen in Star Wars films can be seen in this game, or are at least mentioned in literature. Examples include Galdoran Calrissian, he's a probable ancestor of Lando Calrissian, Cassius Fett, a probable ancestor of Jango and Boba Fett, Comad Fortuna, probable ancestor of Bib Fortuna, and the wealthy Organa family are mentioned early on in the game.
T3-M4 and the Ebon Hawk are modelled after R2-D2 and the Millennium Falcon respectively.
Darth Malak was modelled in part after Darth Vader. The game's programmers wanted to create a Dark Lord of the Sith who would instill images of Vader's character without being a near-carbon copy. Malak were given a cybernetic vocal implant and the rest of his body were pretty much just left alone.
On Taris, the player has the goal of capturing Bendak Starkiller. Starkiller is the name that Lucas originally wanted to use for Luke before changing it to Skywalker, don't you know?
Buragatong, mulira ashangturung omni na potata twangachun tise, igrutu haga jijiwa.
The main game development, graphics engine, and storyline for Knights of the Old Republic was spearheaded by BioWare, whilst LucasArts took charge of the game's audio. A staggering amount of effort went into the game's dialogue, with 300 distinct characters and an impressive 15,000 lines of speech. The voice department manager revealed that the complete copy of the game's script would fill 10 5-inch binders. To bring the vast array of characters to life, an extensive cast of approximately 100 talented voice actors were assembled, including notable names like Ed Anser, Raphael Sabage, Jennifer Hale, and Phil Lamar. Given the game's sheer size, the voice department manager shared a clever approach they adopted.
Now, fortunately, with a game this size, it's easy to have an actor play a few different characters and then scatter those parts throughout the game, so you never really notice it's the same actor you heard earlier.
This resourceful strategy allowed them to effectively use the voice actor's talent across various roles, seamlessly blending them into the rich tapestry of the game's narrative. The collaboration between BioWare and LucasArts ensured that Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic would be a truly immersive experience with its captivating story and exceptional voice acting. The voice production for the game commenced 6 months before the beta release of Knights of the Old Republic. The team was provided with a script that was 90% complete, allowing them to begin their work. According to the voice department manager,
There were a few changes made during recording, but most of the remaining 10% will be dealt with in our pickup sessions.
The pickup sessions, scheduled near the end of the project's completion, addressed performance issues, recording tutorial lines, verbal hints, and anything else that might have been overlooked during the initial recording process. Typically, a game the size of Knights of the Old Republic would take approximately 7 weeks to record. However, through 2 weeks of recording non-stop both day and night, LucasArts managed to complete all the voice work in an impressive 5 weeks. Due to the game's non-linear nature, actors were recorded individually, as recording multiple actors simultaneously would have been too complicated and costly. This meticulous approach ensured that each character's voice and performance would be precisely tailored to the immersive world of the game, contributing to the overall quality of the voice acting. The majority of recorded dialogue in Knights of the Old Republic was spoken in Galactic Basic.
It's represented by English, don't you know?
However, approximately 10% of the script was written in Huttese. To achieve this, they utilised Ben Burtt's Star Wars Galactic Phrasebook, a travel guide to translating English lines into Huttese.
"The key to recording alien dialogue is casting right actor for part,"
remarked the voice department manager. He explained that over the years, some actors effortlessly embraced Huttese, whilst others required more guidance.
"In the past, right, I've had to line read," that's where an actor copies my performance, 150 plus Huttese lines to the actor in order to make it work.
The careful selection of actors and guidance through the recording process ensured that the Huttese dialogue seamlessly integrated into the game, enhancing the immersive experience of the Star Wars universe. The game's score was entrusted to the talented award-winning composer Jeremy Soule.
It will be a Star Wars score, but it will be original, and probably the things that will remain will be the Force themes and things like that.
However, due to technical limitations at the time, Soule couldn't compose a full orchestral score for Knights of the Old Republic.
At the time, we only had an 8 megabit per second MIDI system, and that was state of the art. I had to fool people into thinking they were hearing a full orchestra. I'd write down woodwinds and drums, or woodwind, horn and drums, or strings and drums and brass. I couldn't run the whole orchestra at once. It was impossible.
Despite these challenges, Jeremy Soule's exceptional creativity allowed him to craft an impressive score, capturing the essence of the Star Wars universe whilst working within the technical constraints of the time. Release in 2003, Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic experienced remarkable success. The first shipment for the Xbox sold out within just 4 days, amassing an impressive 250,000 sales during that brief period. That achievement secured its place as the fastest selling game on the console at the time of its launch. Within the first 2 weeks, the game's sales reached 270,000 copies, ranking it as the second best selling console game of its debut month across all gaming platforms. In subsequent months, the game's sales remained strong, with a worldwide total of 600,000 copies sold by October. In the United States alone, the Xbox version of Knights of the Old Republic surpassed expectations, selling a staggering 1.3 million copies and generating $44 million in revenue by July of 2006. Additionally, the game received the notable Silver Sales Award from the Entertainment and Leisure Software Publishers Association in the United Kingdom, satisfying sales of at least 100,000 copies. The game's widespread popularity and critical acclaim cemented its position as a significant milestone in gaming history, showcasing the enduring appeal of the Star Wars franchise and the engaging storytelling and gameplay of Knights of the Old Republic. Upon its release on PC, Knights of the Old Republic achieved significant success as well, securing the third spot amongst best-selling computer games during its debut week. Although it dropped out of the weekly top 10 after 3 weeks, it still performed admirably, claiming 6th place for computer game sales in November overall, and 9th in December. The game made a brief comeback in the weekly top 10 during December 28th to January 3rd, but was absent the next week. Over time, the PC version's popularity endured, with sales reaching 470,000 copies and earning $14.7 million in the United States alone by August of 2006. Notably, Edge magazine ranked it as the 32nd best-selling computer game in the United States between January 2000 and August 2006. The sustained sales and recognition showcased the enduring appeal and impact of Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic, solidifying its place as a beloved classic in the realms of PC gaming.
I'll up about it, but I don't really know much about it. I prefer to keep to myself mostly, but there's plenty of people at the cantina who'll be more than happy to
Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic earned widespread acclaim, receiving the rating of universal acclaim from review aggregator Metacritic. The game garnered numerous prestigious awards, further solidifying its acclaim in the gaming community. Amongst those accolades, it was honoured as the Game Developers Choice Award in 2004 for Best Game of the Year. It received the BAFTA Games Award Best Xbox Game of the Year. GameSpot, a respected gaming publication, recognised its excellence, naming it both Xbox Game of the Year July 2003 and Best PC Game of November 2003. The game's exceptional storytelling, immersive gameplay and impressive presentation were lauded by critics and players alike, cementing Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic as a timeless classic and a standout achievement in the gaming industry. Knights of the Old Republic has garnered widespread acclaim, receiving numerous Game of the Year accolades from esteemed sources such as IGN, Computer Gaming World, PC Gamer, GMR, the Game Developers Choice Awards, Xbox Magazine, and G4. Computer Game Magazine honoured it as the Best PC Game of 2003, presenting it with awards for Best Original Music and Best Writing. The magazine's editor praised BioWare for the game's elegance and accessibility, which they believed set a new standard for the genre. In total, Knights of the Old Republic has amassed over 40 Game of the Year awards from various publications, solidifying its status as an extraordinary and iconic title in the gaming industry. The game's captivating story, innovative gameplay, and exceptional presentation have captured the hearts of players and critics alike, making it a celebrated masterpiece in the realms of gaming. KOTOR received numerous accolades from IGN, including awards for Best Sound in the Xbox category, Best Story in the PC category, Xbox RPG of the Year 2003, PC RPG of the Year 2003, Xbox Game of the Year 2003, PC Game of the Year 2003, and overall Game of the Year 2003 across all platforms. In 2007, the game was recognised by IGN as the 27th best game of all time in their top 100 games of all time list. Furthermore, in 2010, KOTOR secured an impressive third place in IGN's Best Games of the Decade, 2000-2009, with only Shadow of the Colossus and Half-Life 2 surpassing it. The game's impact and lasting legacy in the gaming community were undeniable, solidifying its place as one of the greatest and most influential titles of all time.
At the 2004 Game Developers' Choice Awards, HK47 won the category Original Game Character of the Year, don't you know?
In 2007, the plot twist in KOTOR achieved recognition by itself as it secured the second spot on Game Informer's list of top 10 video game plot twists of all time. Additionally, it was ranked number 10 on Screwattack's top 10 Oh My God, What the Fuck moments, solidifying its impact on players and its status as a memorable and shocking revelation in gaming history. Even the Los Angeles Times acknowledged Knights of the Old Republic as one of the most influential works within the Star Wars expanded universe. Furthermore, in 2010, Game Informer placed the game at the 54th position on their esteemed top 200 games of all time list, celebrating its enduring appeal and significance in the gaming landscape. In November 2012, Time magazine recognised KOTOR as one of the 100 greatest video games of all time, further affirming its legacy and its place among the most celebrated and beloved titles in gaming history.
Nice place before the Sith showed up and started bossing us around.
Darth Revan, a significant character from Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic, was originally planned to make an appearance in Star Wars The Clone Wars, the episode Ghost of Mortis, Season 3, Episode 17. This portrayal would have depicted Darth Revan as an influencer to the Sun, who embodies the dark side of the Force. Although George Lucas commissioned the scene, it was ultimately cut before being fully animated. However, the deleted scene was later released for fans to enjoy. In the animated TV series Star Wars Rebels, which aired in early 2017, plot elements from the game were referenced, such as the Mandalorian Wars and the ancient Sith planet Malankar. In a special May the 4th promotion in 2014, a Darth Revan LEGO minifigure was given away for free with qualifying LEGO Star Wars purchases from the online shop or LEGO stores. In April of 2019, there were discussions about a potential Knights of the Old Republic adaptation. Kathleen Kennedy, the president of Lucasfilms, confirmed that they were exploring the idea, stating,
"Ah, yeah, we're developing something to look at right now. I have no idea where things might fall, though."
A month later, BuzzFeed News reported that a screenwriter had been working on a film based on the 2003 video game since spring of 2018, potentially as the start of a trilogy. However, no further updates or comments were provided by the representative. In Star Wars Rise of the Skywalker, The Visual Dictionary, a book guide to the 2019 film, a reference was made to Darth Revan. One of Palpatine's Final Order legions of Sith troopers was named after the significant character.
The impact of Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic extends far beyond its initial release. Its legacy as a beloved classic endures, with its influence felt in subsequent Star Wars games and the hearts of countless fans. KOTOR remains a shining example of what a video game can achieve when it seamlessly blends a captivating narrative, well-rounded characters and immersive gameplay, as well as a beloved franchise.
In conclusion, Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic is a masterpiece of galactic proportion. Its exceptional storytelling, compelling characters, and immersive gameplay make it a timeless gem that continues to captivate players even years after its release. Whether you're a fan of Star Wars or a lover of engaging RPGs, KOTOR is an essential experience that should not be missed. Now, may the Force be with you as you embark upon this unforgettable journey.
And that's a wrap on our exploration of Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic. We hope that you've enjoyed this journey through one of gaming's most iconic and beloved titles.
We've revisited this captivating story, immersed ourselves in the morally ambiguous choices, and relished in the unforgettable characters that make KOTOR such a timeless experience. It's incredible to see how this game continues to inspire and captivate players even after all these years.
Personally, I'd like to extend a special thank you to BioWare and LucasArts for bringing us this truly incredible adventure. And to all of you, our amazing viewers, or as I like to call you, the Orbital Broadcast Bunker crew, thank you for joining us on this trip down memory lane.
If you haven't played Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic yet, we highly recommend giving it a go, whether you're a diehard Star Wars fan or a lover of RPGs. This game is a must-play that will transport you to a galaxy far, far away.
Remember to like this video if you've enjoyed it, and share your thoughts in the comment section down below. We'd love to hear about your favourite moments and characters from KOTOR.
Make sure you subscribe to our channel and hit that notification bell so that you won't miss any of our upcoming videos delving into more exciting retro gaming experiences.
Thank you again for joining us. May the Force be with you, always.
Sorry I'm late, chaps. Right, what are we talking about today? Oh, KOTOR, cracking. Bloody hell though, this script's 16 pages long. It's gonna take us forever to film. Right, who's gonna go first?